Well, thank you. And tonight's subject is Tracing Your Ancestors, the Table of Nations, based on Genesis chapter 10. And I don't know about you, but a lot of people have got a real interest in trying to trace their roots. I don't know whether you've tried to find your family tree. It's quite an interesting subject, a lot of people doing that these days. More recently, people have been trying to trace their ancestors through DNA tracing. Send off a sample, you can do it on the internet and check where to send it off to and so on. You can do all that and find out where you've come from, apparently. Well, I won't be going into DNA tracing. I'll be looking more at a historical point of view tonight. But just as we move on now, tonight's talk, we're going to be looking at several things. Firstly, post-flood civilization. Because what we're looking at, Genesis chapter 10, is after the flood of Noah and what happened to Noah and his descendants and where those families, those tribes, those clans, where they spread through and migrated in the ancient world. So we're looking at what happened after the flood. We're going to be looking at the founders of the, what I call the New World, really, because the Old World, as they knew it, was pretty wrecked and they had to start again. So Ham, Shem and Japheth, the sons of Noah. We look at Ham and his descendants and where they went. We're going to look at Shem and his descendants and where they ended up, and Japheth and his descendants. And lastly, we'll have a conclusion. So let's, first of all, before we get into the actual Genesis chapter 10, just a recap. Firstly, Genesis, it speaks about chapter 6 to 9 of being a global flood, not a local. I remember when I was doing archaeology and speaking to my professor at the time, and he told me that the flood was the result of the ice melting in Lake Van and the water pouring down into the Mesopotamian civilization. But according to the Bible, it was a global flood. Second thing is the date of the flood being about 3000 BC, and also that the flood was known by all ancient cultures. It was a common record. When we look in the clay tablets and the ancient writings, we find this amazing story about what happened. And if you look at there on the right picture, the picture down at the bottom right, is a section of a clay tablet about the Gilgamesh epic, and it speaks about the flood, the Babylonian version of it, and some of them were really quite ancient. According to Josephus, who was a Jewish historian, the first century, parts of Noah's Ark still existed in the Mount Ararat range. He says here in his book Antiquities, it is said that there is still some part of the ship in Armenia at the mountain of the Cordaians, and that some people carry off pieces of the bitumen, which they take away and use chiefly as amulets for the averting of mischiefs. Hieronymus, the Egyptian also who wrote the Phoenician Antiquities, and Niaces and a great many more make mention of the same. So it was common knowledge, not just about Bible-believing historians, but actually pagan and others. Just it was everyone knew about the remains of the Noah's Ark in the Mount Ararat range, just as the Bible said. I want to mention what I call carbon 14 disclaimer, and there's a reason for that, because when we're looking at these things, we're looking at historical records. Carbon 14 disclaimer. And the reason I mention that is because I'm only using historical dating methods with archaeology and I'm not getting into prehistoric theories. The thing about carbon-14 is it cannot be calibrated beyond 3000 BC for the simple reason you can't test it against any kind of historical records. We've been led to believe that carbon dating can be used for 20,000, 30,000 BC or something, and we get these pictures of sort of prehistoric people. And even actually within the last centuries or last few thousand years, you have a lot of wrong readings. In fact, over 50% of them get rejected. It makes you wonder whether why the less than half of them even get accepted in the first place. If you want to speak about, ask questions about that later on, do get back to me. But Dr. Libby was the person who discovered carbon dating, and he actually said himself, "The first shock Dr. Arnold and I had was that our advisors informed us that history extended only back 5,000 years. We'd initially thought that we would be able to get samples along the curve back to 30,000 years, put the points in, and then our work would be finished. We learned rather abruptly that these numbers, these ancient ages, are not known. In fact, it is about the time of the first dynasty in Egypt that the last or the earliest historical date of any real certainty has been established. So we're looking at the last 5,000 years. So let's move on. The first part tonight, post-flood civilization. And if you have a look at the map there, you can see the shaded bits of brown all around Turkey. It's known by archaeologists as Anatolia. Anatolia is a region, basically, that includes Turkey, Armenia, northern Syria, and western Iran, where the brown shading is. If you look on this map, you can see on the right-hand side, you can see Lake Van. There's another lake just below it, which is not named, but that's Lake Ermia. And above those two lakes, you have the river called Araxes, is where the Mount Ararat range actually is, where, according to the Bible, was Noah and his descendants got out of the ark and descended from that point. So according to archaeologists, this is the area where civilization began. Now, I don't know about you, but I was brought up with Sumeria in ancient Iraq being the first sort of major civilization. But that's shifted since then. And now it's Anatolia very much, which is the great excitement. Let's have a look at a number of things. For example, in Anatolia, that particular region, archaeologists look at, they have a diffusion theory of the origin of agriculture. And if you look on the map there, you'll see going on to the over to the west, just above Africa, you'll find the Fertile Crescent. If you just see that there, Fertile Crescent. And that was the beginning, according to their tracing of people movements, where simple agriculture first began and the growing of corn for that purpose. Now, first domestication, also according to the archaeologists, also took place in the same region, can be traced back to that. We also find that first metalworks were also traced back to that place, that area, Medzamor. In fact, Medzamor is not far from Ararat, about 15 miles from there. And they've dug up what would have been about 200 furnaces. They found all sorts of metalwork. They found work from precious stones, tin, iron, even, this is extraordinary, they found steel tweezers, which you wouldn't expect to find, would you? Because they're not supposed to be, apparently, so sophisticated. But these have been found amongst the archaeological artifacts there. We find in Anatolia, if you like wine, the most ancient wine is a Chateau Arata. And it comes just in what's called the Mandoab Plain, near the Ararat Range. Got a picture there of a vineyard just beneath the mountains. The interesting thing about it, if you read Genesis, of course, after the flood, Noah planted a vineyard. It would have been, I guess, just below those mountains. And unfortunately, he got a bit drunk. But just give you some idea of the kind of place there. And we find the first evidence we have of wine growing and of wine was that same region. We find that the first towns appear in the same region. Catalhoyuk is also very well known. Professor James Mallart did a lot of excavation work in the 1960s. Onwards, and they're quite extraordinary sort of houses because they're flat and they have all these ladders and sort of holes going through. That's what they reckon as they reconstructed based on the evidence they could see. But they reckon that was the beginning of the first towns in the same region. We find too the first pottery. If you look on the left hand side, you find simple greenish brown kind of potwork they had. Later on, they developed another kind of pot with red paintings on them. And it spread there throughout the ancient world from that place. We also find the first simple observatory for astronomy at a place called Karahunj near Sisian. And this is a fairly recent thing, but it seems to be a forerunner of like a Stonehenge. And a team of scientists went up there to examine it and to test it and found it appears to be the first place for astronomy, again, in the same region as the Bible speaks about. There's also recently been the work of Professor Klaus Schmidt, and the first temple has been excavated, a religious temple, at a place called Göbekli Tepe, if I pronounced it correctly. Again, in the same area. We also find that the people who study language have come to the conclusion the first proto-language, the original language, was in the same region. And here's an article from Scientific American, March 1990. It says, the landscape described by the proto-language as now resolved must be somewhere in the crescent that curves around the southern shores of the Black Sea, south from the Balkan Peninsula, east across the ancient Anatolia, today the non-European territories of Turkey, and north to the Caucasus Mountains. So again, confirming the sort of the general biblical picture we do have of Genesis. Now let's have a look, Ararat and where Noah and his family began. According to Genesis and the Hebrews, of course they speak about Ararat, and Ararat indeed was not just a range of mountains, it became a place just below the mountains. But the Sumerians also refer to the same place, except they call it Arata. You get the Assyrians calling it Urartu, basically the same place, and it was famous and mentioned in their clay tablets very early on. So where was it? Well, there was a king in the ancient Mesopotamian civilizations called King Anmerkar, which some people consider was Nimrod, mentioned in Genesis. And he set up a big ziggurat, a temple at Eridu, which is biblically known as Arad. And he was also the king of Uruk, which is biblically in Genesis is called Erech. He went off to the land of Arata to get materials with which to build his ziggurat temples. So he went off to Arata, which is basically the modern-day Armenia. And he didn't just go in to get precious stones, but also metal and that type of thing. Presumably he went to Medzamo, we saw that earlier in the slide, to get various metals and have things done. But he also insisted on getting one of the gods. And a lot of these kings regarded that their gods, it was actually ancestor worship. We'll get onto that a bit later. And why did he want to build a big ziggurat down on the Mesopotamian plain? Well, because as the earth settled down after the Great Flood, there were local floods. And of course, it's very flat there, and it's not so good. So if you can't have a mountain, you make one. So that's what the ziggurat, the temple. And it was actually at seven levels, because there were seven passes you had to get through to get back to the kingdom of Arata to get all your materials you needed. And in the actual temple, the kind of Tower of Babel, there would have been the gods, which were idols, and in celebration of the ancestors, ancestor worship. So it gives you some idea of what was actually going on as a backdrop. Here we have a modern map of Ararat, and that's the archaeological Urartu, as you see, bounded by the red lines. And again, if you see those two pictures, the picture of the two lakes, Lake Van on the left-hand side, and just below it on the right-hand side is Lake Ermia. Just north of it, you might not be able to see it in green, Mount Ararat Range just there. So that's a place of really special archaeological significance these days. Well, let's have a look at the founders of the New World after the flood, the sons of Noah, Ham, Shem, and Japheth. Now, if you look at that map, you'll see there are three colour-coded colours, the green representing Ham and his descendants, the Hamites. And if you notice, they mostly spread down from, obviously came down from Ararat, and through, partly through the Middle East, and mostly spreading through Africa. Some of them ending up in the southern peninsula of Arabia, but as we'll find out, also some of them went through into Samaria and through into parts of India as well. If you look at the map, the colour of the brown, that's Shem. Of course, Shem was the father of the Shemites or Semites. Of course, we get the word Semitic. It's still a word in usage. And they mostly settled in the Arabian Peninsula, but again, parts of the Middle East and partly into Europe. We'll find out later why. And Japheth spread far and wide. Quite extraordinary how his descendants spread right through parts of the Middle East, right through to Iraq, Iran, through to Asia, the Far East, and also through Europe and beyond. Don't bother to look at those names. I don't think you'd be able to read them all from there. It's just to give you some idea of the Genesis 10. It just gives you some of these names and some of the descendants that came out of it as they dotted and spread. They dotted on that map and as they spread out. So let's look at Ham. Well, Ham, as I said, and his descendants spread into Africa. And parts of ancient Egypt were known as Kemet, and that's obviously a derivation from Ham. We find from the pagan historian Plutarch from the 1st century AD that he refers to as Chemia, the country of Ham. So basically in the ancient world, it was very well known that that's where Ham and his descendants had spread into Africa, which agrees exactly with what Josephus, the 1st century Jewish historian, speaks about. Now let's look at some of the sons of Ham. Cush being one of the most famous ones. And it basically became known, we call it today, the area of Ethiopia. But the Egyptians referred to it as Kos or Kosh. So you can see the following of that name, Cush. The Assyrians, on their hand, referred to it as Cushu. Now, Josephus says, "For of the four sons of Ham, time has not at all hurt the name of Cush. For the Ethiopians, over whom he reigned, are even at this day, both by themselves and by all men in Asia, called Cushites." So he's basically saying the descendants of Ham, the Cushites, were mostly in Africa, but some also spread into Asia, and we'll follow this through. Herodotus, who's a pagan historian from the 5th century BC, also speaks about the Ethiopians. And they both spread into Africa and to Asia. He confirms that. So let's look at the Cushites in Samaria as they went through into Asia via Iraq. Now there's a place, this picture you've got here is the ruins that was excavated in Iraq, about 12 miles from Babylon, named Kish in the ancient Mesopotamian clay tablet records. There is a clay tablet which is housed in the British Museum, which speaks about this, and it says the flood came up. After the flood had come up, kingship descended from heaven. The kingship was at Kish or Cush. And of course they have many records of the flood. But what they speak about is the kingship, the king's first coming from heaven. Well, in their viewpoint, and you'll see this in ancient records, the mountain was very, very key, coming down from the clouds, coming down from the mountain, down to the plain, to our level. You get this, for example, Mount Olympus in the Greeks. You have the gods up on Mount Olympus. And it's many ancient cultures. You have the Hindus, you have many other cultures, the high places. So the people were coming down, but they were first kings at Kish. Now, there's an interesting thing, because it was there, from that time onwards, we'll find a son, Nimrod, a son of Kish, is where empires first began. And we'll trace this through. Some scholars reckon that King Mesiag Kasher, in the king records of ancient Mesopotamia, could possibly be the Cush mentioned in Genesis. Now let's look at some of these Cushites as they spread in Samaria and India, which you might be surprised about. King Sargon, an Assyrian from about 2100 BC, said something quite derogatory, but here we are, this is what he said. "For 45 years, the kingdom I have ruled and the blackheads I have governed." He's referring to dark-skinned people and their dark curly hair. And basically what he's speaking about is the Cushites. And they were there before him, and he came and conquered them, and he set up an empire. We find from the Book of Sothis, which is a record from the time of Pharaoh Amenhotep III, about the 14th century BC, he speaks about the Ethiopians removing from the river Indus, which is the Indus Valley civilization, dark-skinned Dravidian people before the Aryans came later on. And they came from India and they settled in Egypt next to their cousins in Ethiopia. So we find some of these records there. Arian, a 2nd century pagan historian, says, "The inhabitants of the Indus," that's the Indus Valley civilization, India, "are in their looks and appearance not unlike the Ethiopians. Those upon the southern coast resemble them most. They who are to the north have a greater resemblance to the Egyptians." And of course, they still have a name today, the Hindu Kush. Anyone ever heard of that? It's a pass Afghanistan, Pakistan, right through into India. It was a place where people went through the passes into India. And why was it called Hindu Kush? Well, it was the Indus Valley civilization, and it was Kush because the descendants of Kush in Genesis were the ones who went there. And that's very clear to us. So as your find is unraveled, we're dealing with real history. This is not some sort of mythology we're dealing with in the Bible in Genesis. Other sons of Cush. We haven't got time to go into great depth, but one of them was called Seba. And a tribe called the Sibai or the Sibaeans spread through into India and Sri Lanka. Some scholars reckon, because of the ancestor worship that took place later on, that it's quite possible that Shiva, one of the main gods in India, one of the first gods that came, that was there, could very possibly be the ancestor Shiva or Seba. We're not totally sure where Rama went, the son of Kush. Some scholars reckon, again, it was around India or somewhere around that region. But again, some scholars reckon the possibility of the god Rama. You have Shiva and Rama side by side together in the Hindu worship. And you have Seba and Rama, again, in the Genesis accounts of ancestor worship. One of the other sons was Havilah. And his descendants became known as the Avilatai, and they settled in a place called Avalis, East Africa. Another son was called Sabta. His descendants were the Sabathians, or the Sabs, as they were known. And even to this day, Somalians refer to the founders of Somalia as being the Sabs. They have a long sort of record of that. So basically, the descendants of Cush spread through Africa, where they were known as the African Cushites, and through into Asia, into Indonesia and Australia. Obviously, the aborigines in Australia spreading that far through, and they were known as the Asiatic Cushites. Now let's look at Nimrod. I mentioned him earlier. Some scholars reckon he was Enmerkar. And he gets a special mention as a son of Cush because he was did some quite extraordinary things. He built the first empire. He built Babel, which is known in the pagan records as Babylon. He built Erech, which is known in the pagan records as Uruk, and Akkad, which is known as Akkad. And you get the Akkadian language and a civilization there. And Kalna, which some scholars reckon it could be what was excavated as Nippur. Spreading through in Samaria, of course, Nineveh was very important for him. And Kala, Rehoboth, and Rezin. These places all known, confirming the Genesis account. Now, he was worshipped as a god, as Nimurda, or Nimurud, in the Lagash temple, we find. And as I mentioned before, some scholars reckon he's King Enmerkar, who's called the hunter in the clay tablets of the ancient civilizations, which is exactly what Nimrod's called in Genesis. If you look at these two pictures, on the right-hand side, you'll see what's called a ziggurat, a temple. And this is at Eridu, which is mentioned as Irad in the ancient in Genesis. And there's some debate over this was the actual Tower of Babel or not. But if you look on the left-hand side, you'll see what many scholars reckon is Enmerkar or Nimrod. And you can see that he's a bigger man above the others. That's him up there. And he has a divine ruling rod. And the ziggurat, or the temple, or the mountain, there they built there, with sun worship at the top, the symbol of the sun, is Nimrod. So again, what we find is archaeological evidence for this period. Now let's look at Mizraim, the son of Ham. According to biblical Jewish understanding, he was the founder of the Egyptian civilization. Now, in the ancient world, Egypt was known as Mizraim, according to the Ugaritic tablets in about 1400 BC. Known as Misri, according to the Amarna tablets, clay tablets, about the same sort of period. Known as Muzur amongst the Assyrians, Muzri amongst the Babylonians, or Masri by the Egyptians, even today, still called Masri, which is quite interesting. Now, this is quite an interesting point, because Masri, according to Egyptian records, was the one who led the first, set up the first dynasty in Egypt. And they were the Horus kings. You may have heard of them. And if you look at the picture here, you see the Horus god there. And you see he's got the head of a falcon. And above his head is the sun, encompassed by a serpent. It's a symbol of divinity. It's worshipped as they're worshipping the sun god. And the serpent, which was often on the pharaoh's heads as well, is a sign of divinity. And here we have this Horus king, this god, who was worshipped. Now, why the falcon? Well, that's very interesting, because according to ancient Egyptian records in the pyramids, there's a record of they spoke about their new world that came into being where this land appeared out of the water. Okay, and there was this falcon which flew, and it had a reed in its mouth, which was a symbol basically of the new world starting. Very important if you're an Egyptian in the Nile, because they had local floods quite a lot. And this, of course, according to Genesis, Mizraim or Masri was a grandson of Noah. And the symbol, they see it was a falcon. According to Genesis, of course, it was a dove that Noah sent out from the ark. And the dove came back with an olive branch in its beak. But they, of course, have an adaptation. It's a falcon with a reed in its mouth. But it's essentially saying the same thing. Now, Mizraim had some sons. Great names, aren't they? The Ludim, Anamim, Lebebim, Lehabim, Naphtuhim, Pasrusim, and Kasluhim ended up in Egypt and Libya. I haven't got time to go all through those because this talk would take too long. I'm going to pick out a few of them that are quite interesting. There's another one, the Kaphtorim, a bit of a puzzle for a while. Some of the descendants there mentioned in Genesis. But we found Egyptian, from the Egyptian records, a mention of Kaphtara, which has been identified as Crete. And it seems that this was actually the Minoan civilization that were the descendants of the Kaphtorim, which started about 2000 BC. And then they were overthrown by natural disasters. I remember studying the Minoans at university, fascinating. They had this acrobatic thing of leaping over bulls. I don't know whether you've seen these artwork before from Crete. They worshipped a sort of a bull god in the labyrinth underneath the palace at Knossos. They had a snake goddess also that they worshipped. Other sons of Ham, Put and Canaan. Now, Put became known as the father of the Libyans, and the Egyptians refer to Libya as being Put or Punt. And the Persians referred to it as being Putta. Canaan, of course, is in today the geographical land of Israel, known again as Canaan by the Egyptians, or Canaan by the Phoenicians and Greeks, Kinahu by the Syrians, and Kinahine by the Hurrians in about 1400 BC. So again, all these things were completely historical rather than mythological, as so many people seem to think. Canaan was the father of a whole bunch of tribes: Sidonites, Hittites, Jebusites, Amorites, Girgashites, Hivites, Arkites, Sinites, Arvadites, Zemarites, and Hamathites. We're not going to go through them all. It will take too long. I'm just going to pick up a couple of interesting ones. The first one being the Hittites. I'm sure you've all heard of them. Well, if you've been around about 100 years ago and you said the Hittites believed, some of the professors would have laughed at you, said there's no such thing. The Hittites never existed. The Bible is a bunch of myths and stories made up. Until, of course, they were digging around, and they, guess what? They uncovered the whole civilization of the Hittites, and the Bible again was proved correct. And, of course, the Hittites were famous for their iron chariots, and the skeptics said, impossible. Iron was never invented in that way. It's completely wrong, stupid Christians and stupid Bible believers. Well, guess what they're famous for now? Iron chariots. And there's a picture of one of some of their artwork, just showing you, and so that they get the last laugh against the skeptics. How about the Sinites? Interesting bunch of people, named after Sin. Now, Father Sin was deified; he was turned into a god in Mesopotamia and called the Lord of Laws. There's a hymn from the era of the Chaldees, which is where Abraham came from. And it says, he, that sign, who created the law and justice so that mankind has established laws. He was obviously a key person in their understanding of making laws. And his name appears a lot in the king records. You'll find as you look at the list, the name Sign appears. Now, his symbol is the moon. Interesting enough, he was also worshipped in the Sinai area of Arabia. What's fascinating, of course, is Moses actually went up to Mount Sinai and received from God the Ten Commandments, God's laws, which is very interesting. It was almost like saying, okay, you want the real laws? It's not the ancestor who's worshipped. I'm the one who gives you the laws. Quite an interesting slant on that. Now, this is often not so well known, but the founder of China was known in the Chinese history as Father Sign. And in Xiangfu, the first town around about 2600 BC in the Shenzhen province. And you can actually trace the name China is derived from Father Sign. And we look at this. The ancient Chinese were called the Sinai, according to the pagan historian Arian. We learn about the Sign dynasty in the 3rd century BC. Even in modern-day usage, the Sino-Japanese War, in the Second World War. The ancient Chinese have their own records about Genesis events. We haven't got time to go into those, but they recorded them on pictograms, on ceremonial pots, and this one's a turtle shell. If you want to look more about that, you can go and download my talk called Tracing Genesis in the Ancient Cultures, which we have online. Now let's look at Shem, and his descendants. Of course, Shem is the father of the Shemites, or the Semites, which are known today. And according to Professors Kramer and Arno Pobel, they were very much involved in the early stages of Sumeria. And it seems that Sumeria is actually a Semitic language, a Semitic name. They branched out into Iraq and Iran in the east and went west into Europe and especially south into the Arabian Peninsula. Now, Elam, son of Shem, was one of the best-known ones. His descendants were known as the Elamtu by the Babylonians, or they were known as the Elamites by the Greeks. They eventually called themselves the Halamiti, and later on the Huz, and they were known as Persians. Now, the Elamites, according to Professors Child and Malowin, two experts, said they were the first founders of Sumeria and moved on later on. Of course, the Elamite civilization was dug up. We found that as well. And the picture there on the right-hand side. And they moved from Sumeria to Iran, where they became especially based. One of the districts in Iran was known as Pul. We have records of that. And a tribe came out of that called the Puls or the Pulani, which eventually became known as the Pulani. And they went westwards with a bunch of other tribes and founded what is now, of course, called Poland. There were other tribes in Iran at the time, the Habaroites, and the Croati and Serbi moved westward and founded what we now know as Croatia and Serbia. Now, Asher, that's a very key person, the son of Shem. We learn from Josephus in the 1st century AD, he says that Asher lived at the city of Nineveh and named his subjects the Assyrians. Of course, Assyrians are very well known in the ancient record. We learn from Micah about 720 BC in the Old Testament, Assyria was the land of Nimrod. And this was a place of the beginning of empires, of a master race. And here we have, they became known as the master race, and Shar-Kishati was a title given to these kings of Assyria. They were the forerunners of the Shahs, or the Tsars, or the Caesars, or the Kaisars. So you can probably see where we're going with this and how it develops. Already. Well, Asher, person mentioned in Genesis, was turned into a god, very common in that time, and so the kings after him. And often their name Asher appears in the lists as part of their title. And they were actually called the Ashurs. But the Hindus did not like them. Simple reason, I think it was Dravidians, being dark-skinned, were treated very badly, and it seemed the caste system developed out of this Assyrian master race, where the white ones at the top and the dark ones at the bottom. And in the Hindu records, they call the Asuras the Asuras, the demons. They refer them to them. On the other hand, the Persians seem to have got on quite well with the Assyrians, and they called them the Ahuras, which basically meant good spirits. Their view was good spirits rather than demons. This picture of the one you see there on the artwork is actually King Ashurnasirvan. As typical, as I mentioned, the name Ashur being in his title. Well, here we go. The Assyrians head to Germany. Quite amazing. But 612 BC, the Assyrian Empire was defeated and assimilation occurs. Most of the Assyrians were sort of assimilated into the people round about. But what we do find, we can trace them. Many Assyrians moved to Turkey. We find this from Diodorus Siculus, a pagan historian. And they are known in the Crimea as the Assyriani. Pliny mentions them. And then they become classified amongst these roving hordes, the Scythians, the barbarians up there. They spread into Europe, and the Romans start calling them the Germani, the genuine ones. That's really what it means, that the genuine ones. And they are now listed amongst the Galati, or the Gauls, according to Strabo, a pagan historian. A bit later on, about 400 AD, the whole bunch of people, the Vandals, you probably heard about, the Alans, the Saxons, and the Alemanni, they invade Europe. And Jerome mentions about the same time, he says Asher is also joined with them. He doesn't mean Asher the actual person, because he was dead a long time before, but he means the Assyrians, the descendants of Asher, have joined with them. And so they move into Europe, particularly Germany, and one tribe that comes out of them is the Franks. They move into Germany, and they establish, of course, the city of Frankfurt. And France itself comes from the Franki as well, the Franks of the Franki. And there's this moving together into Germany of the Vandals and the Assyrians, as Procopius, the Roman historian, records. 368 AD, the Saxonian Franki invade Gaul, we find in historical records. And later, of course, Anglo-Saxons invade Britain. They spread through America, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand. So that probably incorporates some of us here, find some of our roots. Now, here's another son of Shem, Arphaxad. And Josephus says he was the father of what was known as eventually the Chaldeans. You probably all heard of the Chaldeans. They were famous as the Magi in Iraq and Iran. They were famous for astronomy, and they were the wise men, even had great influence on kings and decisions made in government. Now, according to the Hurrian culture, in the Nuzi tablets, clay tablets of 1400 BC, there are the people called the Arap-Hura. They are known as Arap-Hu amongst the Akkadians, and Ptolemy refers to them as Arphaxadis. And there was once the population in that area, once called the Kuru Araxes. In fact, there's even a river mentioned named after Araxes. And scholars reckon it's traced back to Arphaxad, the son of Shem. Now, Eber, son of Shem. Well, you can look straight away where we're going with that one on the right-hand picture. We'll trace through about the Jewish people. But Eber was the father of the Hebrews. This is a long time, of course, centuries before the Jewish people as such. And some scholars reckon that the Egyptian records, they speak about the Abiru, possibly also a reference to the Hebrews. Abraham, of course, was a descendant of the Hebrews, or of Eber. And Judah was a descendant of Eber and Abraham, and of course was the father of the Jewish people. And that's how you get those. And the Jewish people, of course, spread throughout the world, as we know. Two other sons, two sons of Eber, Peleg and Joktan. Peleg, the Bible says in Genesis 10, in his time the earth was divided. Now, some creationists have said that this would be perhaps after the flood and all the upheaval that took place. It was these dividing of the continents. But the majority of scholars speak about it being a time when the earth was divided as being the tribal groups dispersed. Now, we can actually trace the name Peleg in the language, in the Akkadian, because divided in Akkadian is Pelukka, whereas Assyrian, to divide, is Palgu. So you're tracing that back to the original person. And his descendants lived in a place called Palega on the river Euphrates. There was a city there once called Palga, and the descendants were known as the Peleski, Peleskians, or Paphlagonians, which became quite well known in Asia Minor, which is modern-day Turkey. Joktan, we won't have time to go into these. He had 12 sons. They basically spread through into the Arabian Peninsula. Lud, the son of Shem. Now, Lud was the father of the Lydians, as Josephus tells us. They were famous as archers in battle. And they were particularly described by Herodotus in the 5th century BC as being quite white-skinned people. They were known as the Ludu by the Akkadians, or the Ludem by the Egyptians, the Ludbu as the Assyrians, and there was actually a town called Ludbu on the Euphrates in Iraq in early times. They migrated into North Italy with the Etruscans. Now, the Etruscans, of course, were famous because the Tarquins came out of them, a ruling class that essentially were there in founding the Roman Empire. And the Lydians were involved with them in moving into Italy. Others settled in Albania. One branch became the Gegs, that's a great name, isn't it? The Kosovars, as we know them today. Another branch settled in what we now know as the Georgians, and others as the Kabyles in Algeria in North Africa. Moving through quite quickly, Aram, son of Shem, father of the Aramaic language, of course, which we still know. Rebecca, the wife of Isaac, was Aramaean, and her family came from that culture. The Arameans themselves were taken captive by the Assyrians into Kerr near Armenia. They moved to Aram, as Josephus tells us, and they were known as the Arami when they moved into South Russia, as Pliny mentions. There were sons of Aram, Uz, great name, Hul, Getha, and Mash. Uz, well, his descendants they moved into Syria, and Damascus was the city they founded as their leading city. There was also a city once existed called Uz in Mesopotamia, and they were later known as the Uzonians. They migrated into Italy as well. Hul, he founded Armenia, according to Josephus, after about 732 BC. This, of course, is the later Armenia. Of course, Ararata, the kingdom of Ararat, was much earlier. And the descendants were called the Halani, the Alani, or the Alans. You may have heard of that tribal group. And according to Marcellinus, the Roman historian, almost all the Halani are tall, handsome, and their hair inclines to blonde. So if that's you tonight, tall, handsome, and hair inclining to blonde, if you've got some hair, that could be your tracing your ancestry. Now, I had to put this toy soldier in, the Vikings. Here we go. Anyone like the Vikings? I loved the Vikings as a child. Now, Getha was the father of the Vikings, and let's have a look. Now, Getha founded the Bactrians, according to Josephus, but he was known as the father of the Goths, or the Guti, records in the clay tablets about 2000 BC, or the Huti by the Assyrians, and they were described as being blonde and fair-skinned. They moved to the Black Sea and the Baltic. A west branch became known as the Visigoths, and they settled in Gotalonia, which then became known as Catalonia, you may have heard of that, in Spain and Portugal. The east branch, however, split into two tribes, the Gratingi and the Ostrogoti, and they moved to what we call now Austria. Some migrated to Gotland, which became known as Jutland, and into Scandinavia. So there we get the Vikings. If you want to trace that through a bit, dig into Jordanes. He was a Gothic historian in the 6th century AD. Mash, the son of Aram. Well, Josephus says he was the founder of the Massanians. They were known as the Mashi, or the Mash, by the Assyrians. The city of Mass was captured by King Sargon, we discover. And they lived next to the Elamites in Iran and became known as the Massadetai. And they migrated into South Russia. They went into Europe and eventually into Poland, some of them, where they were known as the Mazurs. Now let's get on to Japheth. Now he's an interesting character because his name appears amongst the Aryan cultures as being very important as sort of an ancestor for them. And here we have Prajapati. Prajapati basically means Father Japheth. And he is worshipped as a god amongst the Hindus early in about 1400 BC. They obviously recollect even going back further than that. He's known as Japeti. And in the Hindu record, the Indian record, he has brothers called Sharma, which is identified as Shem, or Karma, identified as Ham. And in the Hindu record, Karma was cursed by his father, Satyararati, if I can get the name, which is the Hindu version of Noah in the flood, it mentions. Because he laughed at his drunkenness. Well, if you know the Genesis account of what happened with Ham, and he kind of despised his father's nakedness after he'd been drunk. So here you've got the Indian version of it. Now, a question I'm asking, I can't demonstrate this, but an interesting point. Karma in Hindu religion is seen a bit of a curse. You have reincarnation that goes on, and you try and escape it by getting good karma, and, you know, so you can eventually become God at the end of it, merge with God. But in that, you have the caste system. You have the dark-skinned Hindus, and then you have the white skin at the top, the Brahmins. And in Sanskrit, the name Japitishita means chief of the race. And of course, the Aryans introduced this into India, and they looked down upon the Dravidian dark-skinned Indians, and they developed the caste system of controlling, which came, as I mentioned, through the Assyrian influence. But just an interesting thing of tracing some of these possibilities. Now, the Matsu of China, they actually have quite an accurate record of the Genesis stories. They actually have Nua, obviously Noah, Lohan, which is Ham, and Loshen, which is Shem. And they call Japheth Japhu. That's the name they give to him. And they actually have a genealogy after that too. When we get to the Greeks and the Romans, we have Iapetos, or Jupiter, or Zeus Pater, or Jupiter. It's obviously the great god of the Aryans up there on the mountain, Mount Olympus, and so on. Now, we get to Gomer, the son of Japheth, and according to Josephus, he was the founder of the Galatians, which are originally known as the Gomerites. They were known by the Assyrians as the Gemiria, and King Esarhaddon defeated the Gemira in 677 BC. The Armenians referred to them as the Gemir, and Herodotus, Strabo, and Plutarch, all pagan historians, called them the Gemeri. And they settled in the Black Sea area in a place called Cimmeria, where they're also known as the Cimmerians, which we now call the Crimea. Some of them moved west, where they became the Gauls, into France, or the Galatae in Spain. I think there's even a football team named similar to something like that. And the Celtae in Britain. And of course, we, in the New Testament, Paul wrote to the Galatians, which would have been Asia Minor, which is Turkey, but possibly copies of that taken and spread throughout the amongst the Celts in the ancient world at that time. What's interesting about Wales, because I'm partly Anglo-Saxon myself, but I've got Welsh blood in me, and my ancestors come from North Wales. Gomer, you can still see the derivation of it in the Welsh, because you have what's called the Cymric Celts of the Welsh. And if you go past the signpost in England to Wales, it says, "Welcome to Wales." I've got the dragon there. And, of course, the Welsh is Cymru, meaning Wales. And so Cumberland originally would have been, if it traced back, to derive from Gomerland, or Cumbria, as we call it, the Lake District these days, of course, which is really beautiful. I'm going there at springtime. Wonderful place there. Let's look at Britain. And fierce-looking warrior there. But here we go, the Britons. Now, again, as I mentioned, I'm not looking at carbon dating. I'm not looking at prehistory or anything. I'm just looking at historical records. And what we do trace from a historian called Nennius in the 8th century, he wrote the history of the Britons, and he collected all the pagan histories available in this nation, and he heaped them all up and just compiled them, copied them down. He said, "It's up to you as a reader what you make of them." But he says this in his book, based on the pagan historical records from early times, some reckon going back beyond 1000 BC. Now, Brutus, was the descendant of Aeneas. If you've ever read Virgil's Aeneid and the founding of Rome, that's after Troy. You know the Trojan War? You've probably seen the film with Brad Pitt in it. Anyway, Troy fell and the Trojans fled, and they dispersed into different places. And some of them, according to the historical records of the Britons, they came up the River Thames as we know it today, and they settled in what we now call London. But they called it Trinovantum, New Troy. That was the name given to it. And Brutus ruled in this period between 1104 and 1081 BC. And from that, you get the British. which spread into England, Wales, and into Scotland. The Picts now up in Scotland, there's a reference actually by Eumenius in the 3rd century AD, speaking about the Picts. But before then, they were known as the Caledonii, which you get Caledonian these days in our language in Scotland. And Tacitus, the Roman historian of the 2nd century, refers to them. The Romans called them the Picts because of all their tattoos. They covered their bodies with tattoos and showed it off all naked, and they scared the Romans witless. But there you go. Others in Britain, Scots, the Anglo-Saxons, Romans, Vikings, French. The Scots were first called Scythians, and Herodotus, the 5th century BC pagan historian, calls them the Scythoi or the Scothoi, which became known as the Scots. And there's also a legend, possibly true, of Queen Scota, that was the married to a son of an Egyptian pharaoh, and the descendants of the Scots came from her. But they came to Ireland, in the 5th century AD and settled with King Fergus, the first king, crowned king of the Scots. Anglo-Saxons, they come from Angle and Saxony in Germany in the 5th century AD, and some of the dukes with them. Romans, won't really go into that. They came, of course, Vikings, 700s AD, but also up in Orkney, much earlier than that. And the Normans, of course, quite late on in the scene, 1066. Now let's move to the sons of Gomer, Ashkenaz. Ashkenaz, known as the descendants known as the Askusa, or the Askenios. Homer in his Iliad actually refers to them. He's about the 8th century BC. They're known as the Askeni tribe near the Lake Askenia in Turkey. They moved in southern Russia. They're called the Scythi, according to Herodotus, or the Ashkuzai. They spread east. We can trace them moving to Thailand, Bhutan, Nepal, Burma, Tibet, Vietnam, Laos, Malaysia, Indonesia, Mongolia, China, and Japan. Others went west into northwest Russia, Germany, and Scandinavia. The islands of Ascania, according to the Romans, is what they gave the name for Scandinavia, what we call Scandinavia today. And the Saki tribe is not some sort of drink. Named by Strabo refers to them, moved from the Caspian Sea to Germany, where they became known, of course, as the Saxons. Sons of Gomer, two sons here, Ripath and Togarmah. Ripath was basically the father of the Paphlagonians. They moved into parts of Russia, and they were the Finno-Ugric people, the Finns, the Laps, and the Hungarians. Togarmah was known, the descendants were known as Tilgarimu by the Assyrians, or as Tegarama by the Hittites. The Armenians in their ancient history reckon that the modern, well, 732 BC onwards, they say the origin goes right back to the son of Targum of Togarmah, there mentioned. And Josephus refers to them as the Phrygians, and they moved into modern day what we call Turkestan. Now to the Greeks. Now, the father of the Greeks is Javan, mentioned in Genesis chapter 10. The Assyrians knew them as the Yawani, or the Persians knew them as the Yoana, or the Yaman, according to the Akkadians, or the Avanu by the Babylonians, or the Yavanna by the Hindus. The Greeks themselves called themselves the Ionians. There were actually four waves that came from Asia Minor, Turkey, from the Ionians, the Aeolians, the Dorians, and the Achaeans from about 2000 BC onwards. There were sons of Javan, Elisha, Tarshish, Kittim, and Dodanim. Genesis 10 says, from these the coastland peoples of the Gentiles were separated into their lands. Now, Elisha was the father of the Aeolians. We've had those mentioned just now. They are referred to, his descendants are referred to in the Armana tablets as the Elassia, or the Elassians in the Ugaritic tablets. And a number of scholars trace them right through to what they call them the Hellenes, which is another name for the Greeks. One tribe branched out from them. They were called the Malayis, and they went east into the Himalayas, Malaysia, Malacca, Molucca Islands, Malagasy, Malavia, Malayu, which was the old name for Sumatra, and the Polynesians and Maoris have been traced on this, and recently, whatever you think about DNA tracing, has been a confirmation of that. Kittim, he went off and founded a community in Cyprus and Macedonia, modern-day Yugoslavia. Dodonim settled in Rhodes, island of Rhodes, and also on Asia Minor. And the Dardanians were the descendants, and they lived in what we call the Dardanelles, which is around the way, place where Troy was. Sons of Japheth, Magog and Madai. Now, Magog was the father of the Scythians, according to Josephus. And what a great name here. The Assyrians call them the Magogi. They were known as Magog quite late on by Pliny. And they moved to the north of the Caucasian mountains. They spread through into the people we now know as the Mongolians, the Alouettes, and right through across the Bering Strait to the Eskimos and the American Indians, spreading both in North and South America. Now, the Madai were known as the Medes in the ancient world. The Assyrians actually called them the Madai, and the Greeks called them Medai. And have you probably heard of the famous Medo-Persian Empire in Iran? And they settled all around that part, but they also moved up into the Ukraine and partially also into India, known as Persians. Other sons of Japheth, Tubal and Meshech. Well, they were known as the Assyrians as a Tabali. The Greeks called them the Tibarani. In about 1200 BC, the Hittite Empire collapsed and the Tibali moved there. And from them, the Bulgari tribe came, and we now know as Bulgaria. Some of the names like Tobolsk in modern-day Russia, now known as Tbilisi, are derived from Tubal. Meshech. Josephus mentions him as Mosok. The Assyrians call him Muska. And they moved to the north of Armenia and through to the Black Sea. Xenophon, the pagan historian, mentions them. And eventually moved north into what we call Russia today. And the Moskva, they were known as. And of course, they settled the town of Moscow today. And that area was known as Muscovy, and they became known as the Muscovites. Tiras, the last son of Japheth we've got here towards the end. Now, Tiras, we know from Josephus, was the father of what was known as the Thracians, who were well known in the ancient world. The Egyptians called the descendants of Tiras Tertia, and the Greeks called them Tirsanoi. It's quite possible that Tiryns, which was a second town on the island of Crete in the Minoan civilization, was named after Tiras, and there seemed to be some similar culture, things in their cultures, we'll find out. And most of them settled in Macedonia, Yugoslavia. But, now here's something very interesting, it's reckoned by some scholars that some of the American Indians have descended from this line, from the Thracians. If we compare the Minoan and Mayan cultures, we look at the things that they were doing and their artwork and the way they did things with, there are quite similarities between Minoa and Mayan civilizations, Mayans, of course, being in South America. Julius Firmicus, a Roman historian, said, in Ethiopia, all are born black, in Germany, white, and in Thrace, red. I mean, very straightforward, isn't it? But anyway, the Thracians were regarded as being redskins in the ancient world. Now, let's compare some of the Aegean islands near Greece and Asia Minor with some of the Indian tribes that moved into North and South America. We have the island of Zou, and you get the tribe Zou. You get the island of Andros, and you get the North American tribe Androan. Patmos, you get the Patos tribe. Island of Leros, you get Lekos tribe. Piraeus, you get the tribe of Piros. Naxos Island becomes the Haxos tribe. You get Argus, Island becomes the Aquis tribe. Sicones Island becomes Sicoes tribe. Anafe Island becomes Anafis tribe. Carpathos Island becomes Carpathos tribe. And what's interesting too is from a science article in 1998, surprisingly, scholars have been tracing DNA and they're saying, oh, actually we can trace some of the American Indian tribes going back to that same part of the world, the Aegean, just as some of the historians and archaeologists have been saying. So we come to our conclusion. And a quotation here by Professor William Albright, Dean of Biblical Archaeology, a man highly respected. And he said this about Genesis chapter 10, the Table of Nations. He says, it stands absolutely alone in ancient literature with no remote parallel even among the Greeks. The Table of Nations remains an astonishingly accurate document. It shows such remarkable modern understanding of the ethnic and linguistic situation in the modern world. In spite of all its complexity, that scholars never fail to be impressed with the author's knowledge of the subject. And certainly, my own personal research over the last 20 to 25 years has confirmed that. There's so much more I could have brought in. I could have gone on for another hour, because there's a lot more. Even genealogical tables of some of the pagan nations confirming things in the Genesis account, some ancient records. And I've got tremendous respect for Genesis chapter 10. It's obviously a very ancient document we have in the Bible, and it's very accurate. But the question is, if Genesis chapter 10 is so accurate, what about Genesis chapter 9? What about 6 to 9 of the Noah's flood? What about the book of Genesis itself as a foundation for the Bible? Thank you very much indeed for listening tonight.